All right, we're live. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for showing some love. And you know, when you subscribe, you get notices of when we're going live. Oh, look at that love. Been here since 8 a.m. That's true dedication. I've also been here since 8 a.m. What's up, Carlos? Hi, Jada. Good morning. Show started. I'm your host, Mr. B, and joining me is Mr. Key. Good morning, everybody. Thanks for joining us for Community Meeting Live. We have lots in store for you today, and so without further ado, let's get started by watching this video.
My daughter, my youngest daughter, she was reading this book north of Mexico. She started reading about her father and her brothers and her sisters. This is my family. And she didn't know nothing about it because I never even told her. A lot of people didn't think we win in Westminster. They thought that there was a, you know, lost cause.
When I see Felicitas, I see a strong woman, a fighter, a mother, a pioneer in the civil rights movement, fighting for the same rights for her own family and heritage. I'm Emily Barrera, and I'm an illustrator in the Google Doodle team. Felicitas Mendez, she's from Puerto Rico. Her husband, Gonzalo, was from Mexico, and they lived in California, owned a cantina, and they had an opportunity to rent a farm, but there were segregated schools in their district, and they wanted their kids to have better opportunities. To be honest, when Google approached me with a Felicitas doodle, I had no idea who she was. But once I started doing research, I felt a strong connection, being originally from Mexico and studying in the United States half of my life. My initial creative approach was listening to podcasts, looking for photographs, documentaries, listening to Silvia Mendez, her daughter, talk at schools. And the more I found information about her, I kept identifying myself in her own fight and family.
We live on one side of Santa Ana. We used to take the children across the street to another school just to show them that they could go to any school they wanted.
I wanted to depict the best I could what her and her husband fought for, trying to stop segregated schools in California and equal education for not only their kids, but all their community. I started doing quick sketches, quick thumbnails first, doing either portrait takes or doing a scene, and then taking that to finish, building in the details, cleaning it up, and adding color. For this doodle, I put Felicitas in the foreground, looking slightly over her shoulder. I wanted to show that she was proud as kids of all colors, skin tones, go inside school with her husband, Gonzalo, walking with his three kids as well, just to convey the idea of like how they succeeded. When people see this doodle, I hope that it can start a conversation that Hispanic heritage is American heritage. We're all in this together. We're all part of this country, and we all deserve the same opportunity and chances. I have my own daughter, and I want her to also grow with the same equal rights as everyone else, to identify herself as a Latinx and to identify herself also with this country.
I'm proud that that at least we had the courage to do it, you know, to fight for, not for our children, but for the other children, their children and their children.
Okay, folks, thank you for taking the time to watch that video with us. As it is Latinx Heritage Month, one of the things I wanted to do is bring awareness to people that we may not have been exposed to in our lifetime. And when, as a former art teacher myself, along with Mr. Key, I used to do the doodle for Google contests. And basically, if you've ever used Google search, you've noticed that each month they try to change up the way that the image of the Google logo looks. And so for this month, they chose to focus on the Mendez family. And I wanted to bring awareness to that and also kind of ask you this specific question. Like, what does justice look like to you? So I want you to think about that. It's something that we're all like reflecting on as a staff and also as a community, as lots of things are happening in our country and around the world. And one of the things I want to bring attention to as we talk about that is the fact that Brown versus Board, if you've never heard of it before, actually took place with trying to desegregate schools and the first African-American woman being able to join in an all white school made that happen. But prior to that, 10 years prior to that, this family was really working hard towards making their family be able to attend the same school as their white counterparts. And so I want to say the Latinx struggle is the same as the African-American struggle. And so think about how we can, as a community in solidarity, really support each other. And so I propose a challenge for our community meeting. Some of us might be familiar with what's going on with the news. Some of us might be tuning out. But these are images that are plastered all over social media, all over the internet, news. And recently, there was news around Breonna Taylor, who we've been listening quite intently about whether or not we're going to get justice for her murder. I spoke about this back in the spring during our community meeting live. After Breonna Taylor's murder, then Vanessa Guillen was a soldier that disappeared. They later found her, and she was also murdered. And so a lot of folks have been seeking justice for these lives that have been taken. Far too often, we don't recognize the women in our lives or recognize women in our country that are being abused or that have been killed due to violence. And so we really want to make sure that we lift up our communities collectively and really think about what does justice look like in our community. And so I'm asking you to think about the IAMG as a logo and how can we create a visual that really shows what you think justice should look like. Just like we saw with this Google Doodle, think about an image or a way to really reframe our IAMG initials into a logo. And I'm gonna send out an email with specifics on how to do some research, just like how you saw in the video, how this artist did. And I'm gonna try and feature each week that we have community meeting, some of the submissions from each of our students. So thank you for taking the time to listen. And I hope this has kind of sparked some interest to some of us. And if you have any questions, please reach out to me. All right, it is birthday celebrations. And so I wanna make sure that we lift up the folks that you see here. Let's go ahead and send some love in the chat for them. Happy birthday, all of you folks. Hope you have a special day and that you are well taken care of. Be safe, be healthy, and have a wonderful time. So at Impact Academy, we strive to create and maintain a safe space, both physical and virtual, for everyone in this community. And so I appreciate you doing that in the chat, sending that birthday love. And also, when we have guests, show them some love in the chat and really show what we are like as a community and how that we can really come together. And if you need some help and reminders, right, we show respect no matter what. We respect each other for who we are, and remember that we create a safe zone wherever we meet. And so in this virtual space, we want to respect all aspects of people, including race, ethnicity, gender expression, sexual orientation, socioeconomic background, age, religion, and ability. So thank you for continuing to uphold those community agreements and making it a safe space for everyone to be able to join us here today. As always, there are mindsets, continuing with our team mindset and our reasoning mindset. We want to make sure that we continue to collaborate, build community together, and then also really analyze our world around us, analyze the lessons that you're being taught, and really reflect on your own about what it really means to you and how this translates to your own personal life. And so I'm looking forward to seeing how you guys, or how you folks, really push that thinking and show up in our community. Mr. Key and Mr. B, want to thank you for continuing to do those things. All right, Mr. Key, you ready to do this?
I'm ready.
All right. We've been practicing, not quite, but together, everybody, wherever you are, from the privacy of your home, ready? Let's do it. At Impact Academy, we
love learning, crave excellence,
and access our agency. So we all in our community, college,
and careers.
All right. Love it. Thanks, Mr. Key. So, Mr. Key, take it away for What Did I Miss?
Good morning, everybody. This is this week's edition of What Did I Miss? You know the song. You can sing along.
Twenty-five. 2560. How does an awesome possum impact decorated teacher staff, unite the students through Zoom chats, doing distance learning like academic acrobats? Breathe in, breathe out, you ready for more? Yeah. So what did I miss? What did I miss?
Come on, Mr. Key.
Impact my home sweet home.
I want to give you a social distance hug.
We've been indoors chilling all summer. Pandemic, man, it's such a bummer. Been put a mask outside to save lives. Woo! Hey, everybody, this is Mr. Keith. Welcome to What Did I Miss?
All right, everybody, welcome to What Did I Miss? So excited to have the next two people here with us today. Please welcome Emma. Hi, Emma.
Hello.
Good morning. Thanks for coming on What Did I Miss? I love the artwork that you submitted. Can you tell us a little bit about the image that's on the screen right now?
Well, I like to do art a lot, as you can see, and I like to take some poses. And I draw them out more, and you see how there's red. I use some like blush, and I like to use art apps a lot.
Which art app did you use to make this image?
I'm not sure. I kind of forgot because I don't have my iPad right now. I do the art on my iPad.
Oh, cool. Could you show with us the GIF that you made?
What?
Is that the next image? Oh, I think I'm getting myself confused. Didn't you make a GIF that we're going to share?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Let's take a look.
both of you that I could touch. This is too much. With all the money in the world, you could never buy this girl quite enough. It will be tough. If romancing me with neons is something you should do, make the letters bright and luminous and blue. And get me waking up, shake it up, tangled up. You could be quaking up, make it up, tangled up. You can't be faking it for my love. Before it's tragedy, don't get me tangled up.
So, Emma, how did you make this meme? Can you tell us a little bit about it?
I made it with Kindmaster, and I used the characters of Gacha Club.
Gotcha. Well, thank you so much for sharing your work with us. Keep it up. It's really, really cool.
Okay, thank you.
Bye. All right, thank you, Emma. Please put some love for Emma in the chat. Because the work that she submitted is so great. And now we have John. Hi, John.
Hi.
How are you doing today?
Hello.
So
I'm doing good. Yeah, good. Very good.
Good. So tell us about what you are making.
Well, this picture is, when you enter, you already know, what that is, right, guys? Of course.
Does everybody know what John made here? So, John, give people some hints. What do you see? What are you making?
Well, I'm making the school, in Minecraft.
Awesome. Mr. B, can you take us to the next slide? So what do we see here, John?
Well, we see one of the classes and, outside.
Great. And what about the next slide?
The next slide? Oh, that's Coach G's room. I remember that.
So did you design the inside of every single classroom?
Well, right now in the console version, I only have like two classes done.
What is your goal?
Yeah. To at least finish all the classes by 2021, I guess.
I love it. And this is Mr. Tang's room, right?
Yep.
Cool. Keep it up. I cannot wait to see the whole school when it's done. This is super exciting. Thanks, John.
Yep. You're welcome.
Have a great day.
Have a great day, too.
All right, everybody. So put some love for John in the chat. I can't believe he's making the entire school in Minecraft. Keep it up. If you are interested in submitting your art or poetry, music, singing, or any sports that you are featured in, any videos, please send them my way, and we will feature them here on What Did I Miss? Until next week. Have a great rest of your day, everyone, and I'll pass it over to Mr. B.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Key. Appreciate it. And it is time for What's the... Come on, folks. What is it? Let's see that in the chat. Yep, it's time for What's the Buzz. This is an opportunity for us to learn about different people within our own community and folks outside of our community. And so I have a very special guest joining me today, a good friend of mine, and I'm gonna go ahead and add him to the stream. Hello.
Hey, Mr. B, how are you?
I'm doing well. Hi, Simone. So here we go. So everyone can see who you are. This is my guest here. This is Simone Weffer, a good friend of mine. And can you go ahead and introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about what you do?
Sure. My name is Simone Weffer. I use he, him pronouns. I'm a professor of sociology and Latino studies at Northern Illinois University. But I used to be at University of California, Merced before that. I study issues like race relations, ethnicity, immigration, Latino sociology, social movements, protests, nothing that's in the news or of importance these days.
That's great. Thank you for sharing that little snippet about what you do. And can you kind of tell us a little bit about your journey in life?
Sure. You went old school and got some great, great pictures. So so I grew up in Chicago. I have one younger brother and then my folks. My parents are immigrants. My mother's from Mexico and my dad's from Venezuela. You can see some of my interests here that Mr. B chose. The top right corner is me doing some acting back in high school when I had a full head of hair and no facial hair. And then playing the bass guitar in middle school. And then looking at the bottom again, soccer. That was my big love. I played collegiately as well. And at the top is actually emceeing an event when I was in college. You can see that at that point I had facial hair. And I think my wife, Doris, who Mr. B knows pretty well, would be kind of dubious about the color of that jacket. And then I love the picture that Mr. B got of me and my mom and my dad. I was probably about 3 or 4 in that picture. And the Chicago skyline, which looks nothing like that anymore. It's got even more buildings and is more diverse and lit up at night, but it's one of my favorite locations actually in the city, because you can go to the planetarium and the aquarium, which you can't see, but then you can see the entire downtown area, and it's really beautiful. And if you guys ever get a chance, you should definitely, when you come visit to Chicago, just drive up and down Lakeshore Drive so you can see the variety of the city. My educational journey,
Look at that.
You've been to a lot of places. Transitions. Yeah. So the first one is University of Chicago. That's where I did my undergrad. And then I went to Stanford, and that's where I got my master's and PhD. I did a postdoc at Harvard, and that's where I met Mr. B when he was living out in Harvard and he was in college too. And then I spent 1 year at Babson College, which is just outside of Boston, in a place called Wellesley. It's a very unique college because it really focuses only on business. So if business is what you're all about, that's where you go. Now, for me, it was really interesting because it took all the other majors and disciplines that aren't economics and aren't business and put them in the same building. And we all taught classes together. Ooh. And that was really great for me for my next move, which was go to University of California, Merced, where I was the founding sociologist. So as you guys know, Merced is just down the road from you. Hop on, cross the Altamont Pass, get to the 99 or and take that south. Awesome. Your brother goes to Stanford. That's great, Mia. And you'll find UC Merced. I was hired before campus was even built. I actually interviewed at an old Air Force base there. And so I was the first sociologist hired, and I got to build that campus from the ground up in terms of sociology. I got to hire all my colleagues and we built something really amazing. But then I got the chance to come back home to Chicago. And so I took a position at Northern Illinois, which you see in the upper right-hand corner. And that's where I got my position and in the Center for Latino and Latin American Studies. Now, I like to joke that with University of Chicago, Harvard and Stanford, I've got the full set of all the bougiest schools. I just need to add, well, I almost have the full set. I've got 3 of them, right? Midwest, West Coast, East Coast. Now I just need to get Duke, and I've got the full set of the bougiest schools. But I mean, I had great education at all of those, great experiences, but also some challenging experiences, as we all do in the academic world. No one is perfect. In fact, University of Chicago likes to pride itself that no one has ever graduated with a 4.0 from there. So everyone takes a punch in the mouth every once in a while, but it's important to think about how you react and how you recover and how you proceed from there. So I think that's about it on that.
It seems like you were pretty involved when you were in college as well. Soccer was a big part of a school for you, high school, and so that transitioned into college. Can you talk a little bit about that and how that helped you build relationships with students?
Oh, yeah, definitely. So the two things that I did in college were theater and then played soccer. And while there's no pictures of me playing soccer in college, at least that Mr. B found, you can see that one of the things I ended up doing when I was at Stanford was I started coaching because it was a way for me to stay involved with the game. And it was also great for me to get outdoors and be physically active. You know, when you study to get your PhD, you're doing a lot of reading and a lot of writing. And as you all know, since we've been home, you know, working from home and schooling from home the past, I don't know, what is time anymore? 6 months, 8 months, 2 decades? And Mia, I'll get to that question because that's a great question. You know, soccer was a way that I could be involved with students. It helped me practice my teaching, right? Because if you're a coach, you're just a teacher out on a field, right? Because you're teaching different things. That was really important to me, and it helped me learn how to build teams and how to manage teams and manage personalities. And so I take those sorts of ideas and philosophies into my classroom, that we try and work collaboratively to get to the education destination, whether it's for that class or that unit or the semester or my student's career. I don't like to give people answers. I don't believe in spoon feeding. The only people that get spoon fed are babies, and even my kids aren't babies anymore. And Mr. B was there to meet the first three. but we haven't gotten a chance to have Mr. B and his family meet Maddie, who's our youngest. But I wanted to get to Mia's question. How did I afford that? Well, a lot of it was scholarships. And especially when you go for a PhD, it's such a specialized degree that schools will often pay for you to go get that degree. How did you get to be captain? Well, how did I get to be captain? That ties into my personality. I think you can tell that I'm outgoing. And I also make a lot of really good connections with my teammates and my friends. But I also worked really hard. No one was going to outwork me. And my teams were well known for always being super prepared and being smarter than the other teams, because I was always teaching. Everything's a teachable moment. So part of that working hard meant that those scholarships that I got, to be able to keep them, I had to keep a minimum GPA, which was usually at least a 3.0. Mm-hmm. And so I knew that those were the bars that I had to be at, and I slipped. I always tell my students, especially, you know, when I meet with freshmen at NIU at the beginning of each year, is, you know, I made mistakes. I failed physics twice. Now, that's ended up being why I moved from physics to sociology. But, you know, it shows you don't have to be perfect to achieve your goals. You know, my GPA as a sociology major was much higher than my overall GPA, but that's because I loved it. And so I think it's really important when you start getting to college and thinking about your major, like, it's important to have an overall GPA, but you really want to be great at those things that you're interested in.
So on that note, though, on switching to sociology, why sociology? Why are you continuing this path and working towards sharing this knowledge with your kids, your students?
So for me, sociology just clicked. I didn't plan to be a sociology major. I went to University of Chicago, to study, physics, to be honest. And so, you know, I got an F in my second physics class. So that was a shock. I thought I wanted to try and be a Nobel Prize winner, but I also realized that physics wasn't for me. My personality doesn't necessarily fit with physics. I don't necessarily, I remember clearly doing a lab where you have an air track and there's a piece of dental floss that attaches to a weight and it moves a little boat, and you use that to see how fast it goes to calculate, you know, that gravity is 9.8 meters per second squared. And I was like, but we already know this. What's the point of proving this again? And then it got worse, because then the teacher, who himself was a Nobel Prize winner, which was amazing, and that's what University of Chicago is about, exposing you to do these great minds. He's like, you know, for an extra 5 points credit, now mind you, the lab was only worth 10 points, calculate the frictional coefficient between the stainless steel pulley and the dental floss. And, you know, it was already like 8:30 at night because the lab was from 6 to 9 p.m. I was like, I don't want to stay and do this. So that got me thinking already, like, man, I don't think this is for me. And then I just had this professor that inspired me. And mm-hmm. I think you know, all of you guys as middle schoolers probably have different teachers that inspire you, whether it's Mr. B or Mr. Key or anyone else at your school. And so I was so inspired by William Julius Wilson, who's this African-American sociologist that specialized in studying cities and inequality and poverty in cities, that it just came easy. And he encouraged me to apply for a fellowship, which is kind of like a scholarship, but it lasted over the summer and it paid for me to be in school over or to do research and stay at the University of Chicago over the summer. And so I started doing research for him, and that was after my freshman year, and then it never stopped, and I just kept going. And in fact, you can see one of the books that he read, The Truly Disadvantaged. That's my oldest now, Gabi. She was about a year old. I was applying for jobs. This was probably when I was applying for the job at UC Merced, and so I joked that she was learning it that way, and you can see her there. Wearing my Barcelona hat. That's the greatest soccer team in the world. I'm sorry to say that if you support Real Madrid or any other team, you've made some poor life choices and you should reconsider.
Oh, you started it. Oh, yeah. The chat's about to light up now.
Yeah, we'll see. But you can also see me, you know, that was in the top right hand. That's when I won our second California championship at Gunn High School, where I coached. And then in the bottom left, you can see my office at UC Merced. Gabi was doing a Flat Stanley assignment, which some of you might have done, where Flat Stanley was moving around. Actually, I take that back. It was her cousin was doing a Flat Stanley assignment. We took a picture of him outside my office at UC Merced. But you could see even back then, I would post pictures of my daughters. And now I don't do that at NIU because, you know, they're 16, 14, and 12, and they would kill me if their pictures were posted that obviously. So I just have to hide them in my office. And so sometimes if you look at me, like if I was on campus, you know, if this was a normal year, you would see pictures of them behind me in my bookshelf. And then, of course, for those of you that like cartoons, I have the Boondocks, a little Boondocks comic strip up there as well. And I do have to say, Mr. B has actually given me more hair than I currently have in my little Bitmoji. So I do appreciate that.
Bitmoji, it's hard, man. It's hard to find the exact thing.
The exact hair, yeah. But, you know, I saw a couple I saw a comment about NYU. NYU is a great, great school. It's one, actually, University of Chicago. We used to play NYU in sports. And being in Manhattan is really intense, as you know. Mr. B from growing up in New York, and it's a really intense place and a great place to go to school. And I'm sure your son is being exposed to so many great ideas. And just being in a city like New York, you learn so much and are exposed to so much. And just one last thing, that picture at the library, I think that was Gabi was maybe about 3 or 4. I mean, literally, they had that's UC Merced. They had just installed the sign. It was like the second year I was on campus, they had finally finished the library and they had put up the sign. And so. So I think that was something that was called Bobcat Day. I don't know if they still have it, but it's a chance for the community just to learn about the campus. And of course, now the campus is much more built out. And your cousin is going to NYU. That's great. You know, it's always, you know, I think it's always great when you have family members that go to those sorts of schools, because then they expose you to something, a place or ideas that you wouldn't have. I mean, that's one of the reasons UC Merced was built, was to give families and students in the Central Valley another goal to strive for, because there really weren't enough students coming from the Central Valley into the UC system. And so by putting the newest campus and the 10th campus there, you really saw immediately how it impacted the community, because students started doing better and all the local high schools, they were applying to more schools. They applied to UCs, but not just UCs, places like CSU Fresno, you know, Cal State, private
Stanislaus,
schools.
Stanislaus,
yeah. Stanislaus, right? So all these schools saw upticks in students applying for college because they saw it was tangible, right? It wasn't something that was far away. Like, mm-hmm. if I mean, you know, you're close to Berkeley, it's something that's tangible. You can get there. But when you live in the Central Valley and it takes you 2 hours to get to Berkeley, it seems like forever and ever. And it's far away that it might as well be on the other side of the moon, right? Especially if you're coming from a farming community. So I think it was really great. And it was one of the things that led me to apply and to take that job, because it was a chance to do something that was so impactful for the Latino community. You know, almost from its beginning, it was considered a Hispanic serving institution. And for those of you that don't know what that is, that's a school that meets a certain threshold set by the federal government as to how many Latino students it has. And so I think within the second or third year, it had met that like 35% bar. And so it's always been very diverse. But, you know, that brings other challenges, whether it's financial or cultural. And it's something that, you know, we as faculty really embraced and tried to work with our students to make sure they could succeed.
I have a couple more questions for you, and thank you for kind of connecting for us specifically how UC Merced was trying to serve the community within the Central Valley, and then also connecting that back to how you as a sociologist wanted to make sure that you also gave back to the community. When you go into your classes each day or each semester rather, and you think about the state of the country, the state of the world, and there's so many things going on, first question and second, how do you choose what to bring up for conversation? And then recently we heard they decided not to prosecute the police officers that murdered Breonna Taylor, and folks are on different sides of opinions around that whole situation. How do you as a professor remain neutral, and then also support students who are grieving, or people that you know personally who are grieving by these decisions? And what can you offer our staff members and some of our students who are struggling with this?
So I think there's so many things to unpack. It's such a great set of questions that you asked. The first thing is I always try and give my students, whether it's online and synchronous or asynchronous. For those of you that don't know what that means, synchronous means that it's happening at the same time. Like,
oh, they know. Oh, they know.
I know, but you got to be careful. You don't want to make assumptions. Right. And so asynchronous. So for example, in my synchronous classes, I'll just open up the beginning of class. And that's what I did this past Monday. Now, it was before we got the Breonna Taylor announcement from the grand jury, but we had something happen at our campus at NIU, where our Center for Black Studies had the N-word painted on it. And that had happened late Wednesday, early Thursday. And so, you know, for me, the entire faculty, it was shocking. But as a faculty member of color who has a lot of students of color, and specifically Black students in my classes, it was really traumatizing, right? Because that's supposed to be a safe space. Mm-hmm. But that's, of course, why it was targeted. And so for my synchronous class on Monday, I just opened up the floor. I said, let's just talk. Let's, you know, we'll get to the material. And if we don't finish the material, we'll just talk about it next class. And just let people work through what they're thinking. Mm-hmm. And then at the end, or when relevant, I'll come in and tie it into what we're reading and discussing in class to make sure they see how it ties in. And, you know, this is the class I teach on Mondays is actually a night class for my graduate students. So these are master's students. So most of them are at least 23, 24, but I have some that are, you know, in their 30s or 40s as well. And so I make sure I'm tying it back in so they can see how these theoretical concepts that we talk about race, such as racial minimization, which says, oh, well, you know, it's not that big a deal that X happened, actually plays out in the real world. Mm-hmm. So that's one way. Now for my asynchronous stuff, I will often, I always have a journal that I ask students to keep and write at the end of every week. And there they're supposed to just react to the readings, and I encourage them to react emotionally and viscerally, but also then in the second part sort of tie it back in. But when something big happens, like the Breonna Taylor decision, I'll just send out an email and say, hey, you know, please feel free to use the space to talk about what you're feeling. And then I can I can react to that in writing. So my students see that I'm acting and interacting with them, mm-hmm. and I can give them some ideas about how to help process it. For the asynchronous class I'm teaching this semester, a lot of those students I've had in class before, so I know them, right? And so I'll say, hey, you know, I know you're really into art. Maybe you can paint through the emotions and feelings that you're having, right? Maybe you want to create a tribute to Brianna, or you want to do a Black Lives Matter. And in fact, I'm actually going to plug one of my students because she did this shirt, and I hope everyone can see it, right? And it's got sort of all the social movements that probably you and many, or I and you and many of your students identify with, right? We've got Si Se Puede from, the Latino social movements, Black Lives Matter. Of course, we've got the raised black fist, which comes from the 1968 Olympics when John Carlos and Tommy Smith were protesting racism in the United States after winning the gold and bronze medal in the 200-meter sprint. And they're California guys, actually, one from the Central Valley and one, actually, John Carlos was from New York, but they went to school at San Jose State. Yeah. But anyway, so that's how I will encourage students to process it. Now, you know, you asked, how do I remain neutral? And it depends on the topic. And there's sometimes that I'll just be honest and say, I can't be neutral on this. Mm-hmm. And I can understand if you disagree with me, and I encourage you to disagree with me, but I'd like you to try and understand where I'm coming from or where your fellow students are coming from. But where I try and remain neutral is letting everyone voice their opinion, mm-hmm. but I will push back, right? So for example, in the Breonna Taylor case, if there was a student that said, well, you know, the grand jury came back and didn't find anything, so clearly that's okay. You know, I would push back and say, okay, well, we need to investigate who was on that grand jury, right? Mm-hmm. Let's think about how this is a case of structural racism, right? If that was all white members of the grand jury, right? How can that create a different outcome because she was an African-American woman, mm-hmm. right? Why is it that they came back and essentially gave justice to the walls and the neighbors, but not Breonna Taylor? How do you think they got to that answer? How would you, or sometimes I'll flip it and say, okay, if you were there and you saw the evidence, right, how would you think about it?
Or, in a way, you're pushing their critical thinking and the analysis.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right. Because that's the key, right? At the end of the day, it's totally fine to me if someone disagrees with me and their opinion is based on facts, on substantiated theories, on maybe nuance, right? Sometimes you can be on different sides of the argument, but it'll just be one or two little words that flip the difference, mm-hmm. right? And so I'm okay with that. And I want students to disagree with me because that's the only way through give and take that we can get to a place where we understand and we learn. Mm-hmm. And that is really something that I learned at the University of Chicago, right? It believes in this oh, you're welcome, Shruti. I hope I pronounced that right. Mm-hmm. I think that was something that was really instilled in me, the importance of debate. And debate is not who can be louder, right? Debate is who has the better ideas and the facts to back it up. And that's the problem that we're in society right now, is that so often people are latching onto things that they think are facts.
Right.
But they're not. And so it's really hard to stay informed with those facts. I mean, we see that with the whole movement against wearing masks. Now, you know, one simple counter argument that I use is, well, let's look at the countries that have gotten COVID under control and what do they do? Now, China went completely authoritarian and locked people in their houses, right? Mm-hmm. That's not us. But what did Japan do? Japan's an industrialized country, a democracy. Well, everyone wears masks. Like, everyone wears masks. Right. If you were to go on a live cam in Tokyo, everyone has a mask. And so, you know, it's those things that I'll do. Well, you know, I think it's all a hoax and da da da, or I had this breathing problem. I'll go, okay, well, you know, do you have an iPhone or something like that? you know, can it measure your pulse ox levels? I think it can. Why don't you measure your pulse ox with the mask on and without? And I'm pretty sure I know what the answer is, right? And so, you know, sometimes you've got to do that and cajole people. But, you know, here's the sad thing. And I've had to do this with some friends that I've known since I was a kid. There's some family members for both me and my wife that don't believe these things. And then it's really hard, but sometimes you just have to step away and say, I can't change someone's mind. Mm. And I have to do that sometimes in the classroom. And let me give an example. So, you know, sociology studies social problems, and we try and then explain the social phenomena, why they happen. So, you know, let's take a city like Oakland. We might try and explain the inequality within Oakland. But I had a student in my urban sociology class that she strongly believed that sociology was only about making Black people look bad. Now, I tried to, you know, take the other's position and try and understand why she was doing that. And so the idea was, well, we're reading all these stories about poor African-American neighborhoods and things like gangs or unemployment or teenage mothers, right? And so I said, okay, I understand what you're saying here, right? But what we're trying to do is we're trying to look at society's problems, understand why they happen,
right,
and then try to fix them, right? So, you know, impact's a great example. People were concerned about the quality of schooling, right? But there's only so much you can do with public schooling. Well, what's another opportunity, right? What if I create my own school? What if I create a new opportunity and a new model which uses different pedagogy to try and reach these same kids, mm-hmm, right? And so, right, that's looking at a problem, urban education, trying to find a solution, and then executing that solution. But if you only look at its identifying problems, then I can see where you come to that point. And we argued for about 20 minutes, and eventually I just couldn't move her opinion. And other students tried to move their opinion, and it didn't work. So so that's what happens sometimes.
Sorry about that. Wrong.
Oh, comment. No worries.
Yeah, that's the one. The student said this. Mm-hmm.
It is very hard not to do that. It is very, very hard to walk away, and we all struggle with that, and that's okay. You know, because on some level we're admitting defeat that we couldn't convince someone, but you literally can't win them all. No one's perfect in any of these arguments, and that's okay, but you have to feel okay with the arguments you made and the way you interacted with the persons that disagreed with you.
All right. I'm gonna ask you one more question. And I think this is geared towards our staff. So at our school, we've made, as an organization, it's called Envision Schools. The focus has been for the past couple of years about being a pro-Black organization and being anti-racist. And a lot of the things that have come up is about, well, saying it is one thing, but where are the actions, right? And so where are the actions behind that? And so there's been work, professional learning, and we've done a lot of looking in the mirror, and we've done things across difference. And so we get to a point where sometimes it still feels like it's not enough work. And some folks aren't being vocal enough, or some folks are. And so as a staff who are trying to unite around this common thread of supporting our Black and Brown students in our community, and given the things that are going on now with COVID, and then also what happened with Breonna Taylor and Vanessa Guillen, what can you offer as advice for our staff who are struggling themselves emotionally with everything that's going on, but then have to go and then teach a class?
Right. I mean, it's something that we struggle with at NIU. You know, we're having these same debates and same conversation. So if I'm not sure it does make you feel better, but it does make you feel better that we're all having these conversations.
If everything's all good for you, you understand all of our univocal.
Something happened?
Oh, sorry. I got some random audio in my ear. Some weird feedback. Sorry.
Okay.
So I was literally hearing voices there for a second. It's very odd. So anyway, what I was going to say is we all struggle with that in any educational situation. And at NIU, it's particularly difficult because in terms of African American and Latino faculty, we still make up less than 10%. So out of 670 faculty, we are maybe in the high 50s or low 60s. So it means there's a lot put on our plate. And one of them is dealing, one of these big things is dealing with that. And so, so in terms of how do you work through it, how do you commit, you've got to start, you know, at the very base level, right? So working one-on-one with your students, making sure that your pedagogy is right in the classroom, making sure that you've analyzed your readings or the videos you show or the films or the plays, and make sure you understand where there might be friction points. So for me, I teach a sociology of sports class, and we read Friday Night Lights, which is very different than the TV show that some of you might have watched, because it really gets at some of the racism that adults have that is directed towards 14, 15, 16-year-old boys, right? And there's some very strong language in there. So what I do is I work to prepare my students to deal with that language, right? Not to coddle them, right? But it is, it can be jarring and scarring to see some of the words and phrases that they use when you think about the fact that it's aimed at a child.
Right.
So that's the first level. The second is to work with, you know, the peers in your department. And you can't necessarily get everyone on the same page. And that's okay. The key thing is you need to identify who your allies are, but more importantly, who your accomplices are. And so the difference is, look, an ally is someone with you, but an ally can also change sides, right? An ally, for those that play games like Risk or Access and Allies, actually, right? Allies can defect. But your accomplice, that's your ride or die, right? That's someone that no matter what is going to support you, but they're also going to tell you when you've stepped over the line and tell you when you need to go farther and make sure you have the resources for your own self-care. I think that's the big thing. Like, I can't stress enough that it's important to have those relationships, at least one or two within the building or within your department, where you're going to look out for each other on that level. And that's the hard part. I think that's the hardest part, right? Because now we're physically distanced, right? I don't like the term socially distant. We should be socially together, just physically distant. And it's hard to maintain those bonds. And so we have a group of us from University of Chicago that have known each other since we were 18, 19 years old. Every Friday night, 9 o'clock Central, 10 o'clock Eastern, 7 o'clock on the West Coast, we're on that Zoom and we're hanging out and we're sharing stories about work and sharing stories about our kids and talking about politics. You know, last week was really hard with literally we got the news about Ruth Bader Ginsburg a couple hours before we got on our Zoom. So it was a chance for us to release it all. And so I think that's an important part. Now, at the end of the day, you also have to ask yourself, you know, who are the key people in your organization that you need to target to make sure you're getting the resources to do the anti-blackness, anti-racist work? And, you know,
I think you meant pro-black anti-racist.
Yes. Sorry. Oh my God. There's a Freudian slip. To prevent the anti-blackness in your organization, right?
Yeah.
Anti-black biases. And so, because one of the talks that I've given quite a bit this year, I think three times now, is anti-blackness in the Latino community, right? Where we need to confront our own isms in the Latino community, and one of them is colorism.
Mm-hmm.
But so, you know, identify those things. But it's hard. It's hard work, and it's not perfect, and none of us can be perfect on it. It's almost impossible to be perfectly anti-racist at all times, because sometimes we'll do things like, oh, well, I'm not racist because if you look at that person, right? Or if you look at that school, and so it's easy to fall into those traps and not think about, okay, wait, why am I talking about someone else? I need to be focusing on me and what I'm doing. And I would also just, you know, encourage the non-black and brown faculty to just check in with your black and brown colleagues every once in a while just to make sure they're okay. That's one of the big things, and it really means a lot. I know as a Latino faculty member, the couple of emails that I've gotten since last Thursday and what happened at Center for Black Studies said, hey, are you doing okay? Because I know you're taking extra load by having to be the one that the Latino students are going to work through all this stuff. And the African-American students, because they might not have any African-American faculty that they've gotten to work with, but they've taken your class, you know, are you doing okay? And so, yeah, I guess that's a really long-winded answer. I hope I gave someone some nugget somewhere in there, because it's just so hard. I mean, to be honest, it's so much. There's so much to do. There's so much yet to do that it can be overwhelming. But if and I think every teacher feels this way, if I can just reach one student this week, one student this semester on this, then you get that success, you get that win, and you chalk it up, and it means a lot more. But you know, we do need to be able to talk about systemic racism and structural racism and how all these things play out. I'll give one last example. My kids go to a school that's named after Louis J. Agassiz. And it's a great school. It's an IB program. They focus on the arts. It's really multi-ethnic. But Louis J. Agassiz was a racist. He was a eugenicist. He worked at Harvard at a time when he could espouse racist ideologies and claim that they were scientific. And so we've been working for 3 years to try and get the name changed. But we've had significant pushback from people in the building and outside of the building. Administrators, some teachers, the power structure in Chicago Public Schools, but we're finally making progress. And it's taken a sustained amount of effort and mobilization, something that I study, by parents and by students. But now the difficulty is, okay, we're going to change the name. There's a process in place, but there are teachers that are afraid to use the R word, racism, as if students are too sensitive to understand it. You know, we shouldn't, you know, I listened to a conversation that my second grader was in about this, and it said, well, Agassiz was a great scientist, but he said some not nice things. No, it's not. He said not nice things. He was a racist. He said anti-black things. And maybe you don't want to use the word racist, but if you say he singled out black people and made them less than everyone else, that's something a second grader can get. And Maddie understands that. You know, it's not like we sit there at the dinner table and talk about, you know, Foucault and Derrida and you know, critical race theory. I think my kids would throw their food at me if I tried to do that. But we are honest. And having a wide range of daughters from second grade to sophomore in high school, that's a wide range of having these discussions. But we have those discussions. And so, right. So Maddie might not understand what Gabi's getting at when she, as a sophomore, is getting worked up on her call because someone's being racist or sexist in her computer science class, and she feels that they need a beatdown. And as you know, Gabi has no problem delivering beatdowns. And
we're talking about verbal, though, right?
Yeah, verbal. This is virtual. Yeah. And intellectual, right? She's not going to back down if someone says black people don't do X, or why are you a girl doing coding? She's never going to back down from that.
Right.
And that's because very early on, we always had those honest conversations, right? She understood that she was different. You know, having a Latino father and a Filipino mother. So she understood, like, her world was different. And we were honest about that. We didn't try and say otherwise. And I think it's important for parents to have those conversations. I think it's important for students to have those conversations. And it's important for teachers to have those conversations and not try and sugarcoat things. Because what I always tell, what I've been telling parents since George Floyd really brought it to a head for many non-black and brown families, is that you will be amazed at how kids' brains can stretch to understand things if you just take the time to talk to them. And so, you know, that's a real life personal situation where I'm trying to teach anti-racism, teach about anti-blackness and how impactful it is. and fight against the powers within the system to get to the right result. I don't know what the eventual name of the school will be. I'd be fine if it was just the Lakeview School, because that's the neighborhood it's in, or if it honors Ruth Bader Ginsburg, or I just blanked on the name. Maddie actually came up with this name. She's an African-American dancer that actually started in Chicago. Catherine.
Is it the ballet dancer?
Yeah. Catherine Dunham, maybe. She's older. Or you know, Grace Hopper or Frida Kahlo was another one that Maddie came up with, right? A woman artist of color, because the school focuses on the arts. You know, the important thing is having those dialogues and making sure those dialogues are working. And that's where I'm worried about the school leadership not being direct and forceful and saying, yes, it's okay to say something is racist. And you know, maybe not appropriate for a kindergartner, but a second grader can get that. A fifth grader can get that. So anyway, I hope that answers your question and shed some light on it.
I appreciate everything you said. And one of the a couple key takeaways that I'm getting from this, both for students and faculty, is first, self-care. And then also, like, really take time to figure out, like, who are your allies, but also who are your co-conspirators? Who are the folks that are really going to be there to support you through the lowest of lows and really help push against the system in the way that if you're being oppressed, they're going to be there right alongside you to fight with you. And so I appreciate you taking the time to be here with us and to share that knowledge and experience. And you know, I love you and I love your family. So thank you.
Yes, and we miss you guys so much. Please give Cheyenne and the girls big hugs from their sisters in Chicago.
Definitely will do. Whoa. I had one quick thing to do at the end. That voice you were hearing is Shai teaching her drama class in the background. Yeah.
That's great. Yeah. That's awesome. Okay, you have one more thing to do. Okay.
I figured I'll test your own knowledge about the schools you've been at. So can you name all the different mascots?
Oh, sure. No problem. That's easy. So University of Chicago is the maroon. The color, not the people that are maroons. Stanford is the cardinal, but the mascot is a tree. Go figure. It's because Palo Alto has a huge tree in it. Harvard is the crimson, again, a color. So if you notice, all the schools that I actually got degrees and did academic stuff at are colors, and they're red-based. So I've gone from maroon to cardinal to crimson. NIU is the Huskies. UC Merced is the Bobcats. And then Babson is the Beavers. I know you tried to get me on that one, but that's actually one of the first slides in my sociology of sports class. I go over all the mascots. The one other one that's not on there is San Ignatius Wolfpack, which is another maroon and gold colored school. So really, Babson's the only school that didn't have red, and UC Merced, because that was kind of gold and blue, like all the UCs, are the only two schools I've been at that aren't red based.
You have quite the experience in schools and universities, and I appreciate you sharing all that knowledge. We are an arts and technology middle school, a high school. And so a lot of our students that are in the middle school, their siblings have either passed through our high school, or they themselves as middle schoolers will be passing through our high school. And so I hope we just expanded their horizons in terms of different schools that they can actually, they could potentially attend. And once again, appreciate having you here, and I hope you have a wonderful day.
Thanks. And I would just like to encourage any of the parents, staff, students, if you want to get in touch with me, you can find me on Twitter, you can find me on Instagram, you can find me through the NIU website. I'd be happy to chat about college stuff, about being Latino or a person of color in higher ed, because we didn't get to talk about that. But maybe we can come back and talk about that another day as well.
Appreciate you. And everyone, you know what time it is. That's the buzz. All right. Thank you.
Take care.
Take care.
So if you want any like refreshers or anything like that, we'll help you out. Information that you're building. Mm-hmm.
This is a song by the Chemical Brothers, Galvanize. So come together, folks. Mobilize. Do the work.
If you think about it, so many people do be cool and look smarter.
Don't hold back.
And you shouldn't even care about those roses in the air and the crooked stairs.
Don't hold back.
Cause there's a party over here, so you might as well be here with the people who care.
Don't hold back.
On you, you'll be leading
on the time has come to.
You'll be your
world. The time has come to.
It may be a little choppy.
The time has come to.
Don't hold back.
My finger is on the button.
Okay, so overall, I'm looking at